Your Eminence, Cardinal Collins, Chancellor of the University of St. Michael's College, President and Vice-Chancellor, Mr. Maroney, dear faculty, students, and friends, it is truly a great pleasure for me to have this time of prayer and reflection with you this evening. It is even more pleasing that I have been asked to speak with you and to offer some guidance on living the Christian life. The motto of your esteemed university, taken from Psalms 118, and your great founders, the Basilian Fathers, is "Teach me goodness, discipline, and knowledge." I would like to reflect a little with you on how we can develop these three virtues by living well the Christian life in our world today, a world which I have described in my last book, The Power of Silence, as dominated by a dictatorship of noise. In 19th chapter of the first book of Kings recounts the retreat of the prophet Elijah to Horeb, the mountain of God. There we read, "And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face with his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, 'What are you doing here, Elijah?'" This brief passage ends with a question each of us must ask ourselves: what are we doing here? In other words, what are our lives for? What kind of people are we called to be? What happens after our earthly journey has ended? These are profound questions, questions of the highest importance. Yet, we cannot arrive at these profound questions, and we certainly cannot begin to answer them until we receive the wisdom in the first part of the passage: "The Lord is not in the wind, or in the earthquake, or the fire." We will not find answer in the loud and tumultuous event of history. We are not going to discover profundity in what passes quickly. In this passage, we hear the question, "What are you doing here?" only in silence. Only in silence does Elijah encounter the Lord. It is the same for us. Only in silence do we ask such profound questions. Only in silence do we begin to discover who we are and what we are called about. Only in silence do we encounter the Lord. In what follows, I would like to reflect on how we cultivate silence in our hearts and on how important it is to do so. First, let us consider the challenges we face. Silence in our hearts is difficult to achieve. We live surrounded by noise. The world never seems to slow down. There is always news, always scandal, always opportunity demanding our attention. It is not only that we often live surrounded by audible noise. It is not only that we live exposed to constant busyness of the world. Our hearts too are frequently filled with noise. Even more, so many words and events stir our emotion and demand our response. If you are not careful with our heart, the noise can become constant. We can find ourselves pulled in so many directions, in every moment, pulled apart by the news of the world. We can live our whole lives plunged in, connected with friends, family, and the unfold of human history across the world, but without ever slowing down for a moment to disengage, to encounter our own selves, or to encounter God within us. Jesus himself asks, "What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" This was the question posed time again to St. Francis Xavier, one of the first Jesuits, who went on to evangelize that portion of Asia in the 16th century. Francis was from a noble Spanish family and chose initially to follow an intellectual path. At a renowned college in Paris, La Sorbonne, studying philosophy and then going on to teach it. There, he came into contact with an older student by the name Ignatius of Loyola, who brought together a group of students who desired to glorify God by their lives. At first, personal ambition kept Francis from heeding God's call. Ignatius' humble and austere lifestyle did not appeal to him. But the older student, who had undergone a dramatic conversion, posed him the question of Christ, "What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?" Gradually, Ignatius convinced the young Francis Xavier to give up his own plans and to open his mind to God's will. In 1534, Francis Xavier and five other men joined Ignatius in making a vow of poverty, chastity, and dedication to the spread of gospel. This is the beginnings of the Jesuits. Francis became a priest in 1537. Today, he is a saint. In the end, only this matters. What shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? We can take this question quite literally. Through our technology today, we have access to the whole world. But if we do not forgo some of these apparent opportunities offered to us by technology, if we do not slow down, if we do not take the time to cultivate silence in our hearts, we'll never know our own souls. We'll be lost to ourselves. To avoid this fate, I invite all of you here to consider with me our relationship to technology. First, we should acknowledge that technology does, in fact, offer us wonderful opportunities. It has changed our lives. With a smartphone, I can call almost any of my friends and family right now, everywhere they are in the world. I can text them, email them, video chat with them, look up what they have been doing or thinking recently on Facebook or Twitter. I am connected to them in ways that I could not imagine in my own lifetime. What extraordinary fruits of human creativity, what opportunities this technology holds for drawing the human family together in solidarity and affection, for building one another up, and for coordinating our efforts to care for the least among us. Yet, such magnificent opportunity carries with it great risk. Technology has created revolutionary on our lives. Much has been written on the physiological and psychological effects of our use of social media. It has changed our spiritual life too. For many people today, our extraordinary connectedness to one another has robbed them of silence. Having lived without silence, silence has become unfamiliar to them, even painful. Many people today are uncomfortable with a few minutes of silence. A silence commute to or from the workplace, a lull in conversation, an evening at home without technology. Have you noticed that on train or bus, in the airport, or even families sitting together in a restaurant, almost everyone is on their smartphones? Yet, in years past, moments of silence were precious to people. They were moments of relax, to unwind, to let the heart rest in the silent presence of God, each other, and myself. Today, many people relax or unwind with music or a movie or social media. But these activities can distract the heart. Through them, we remain embedded in the business of the world, embedded in the business of others. As a result, many people simply do not relax or unwind as thoroughly as they might. Our hearts truly rest only in silence. If we do not know silence, if we do not rest in silence, if we do not truly rest at all, if we do not rest with silence, we do not rest truly at all. Instead, we remain always at work, just work of different sorts. In this way, we exhaust ourselves, we deceive ourselves, because we deprive ourselves of the rest that is necessary to live well. Without silence, we put ourselves forever in risk of burning out, of utterly exhausting our capacity for fruitful labor. In contrast, silence allows our hearts to rest. Yet, silence is difficult to achieve. First, it demands that those who fear silence face their fear. It takes practice and discipline, and likely some degree of suffering, to separate ourselves from all sources of destruction in our lives. Second, even after we have separated ourselves from external sources of destruction, we must still face the conflicts in our hearts. Often, our interior lives are mysterious and troubled, and therefore also often ignored. Again, it takes practice and discipline and a good deal of suffering to develop the virtues by which we bring order in our interior lives. But this is possible. Every one of us is capable of virtue. Never should we believe that we are not, because every saint, but one or two, began as a fallen human being like you and like me. God blessed us constantly with the knowledge and the strength, with the role models and the companionship that we need to grow in virtue. Virtue quiets the heart. Someone who has formed powerful habits of temperance in enjoyment, courage in every situation, justice in all his affairs, and prudence in his singing, can step away from the destruction of the world, both external and internal. His heart is quiet, but quiet is not yet silence. Silence is a positive thing. Silence is quite chosen. You are silent when you choose to enter the mystery of our own souls, when we choose to encounter ourselves without distraction, when we choose to attend to the silent presence of God in our hearts. In this silence, we find true rest. From this silence, we draw all the strength we need to live our lives. In this silence, we take refuge from exhaustion and from the oppressive noise of the world. It is a great achievement to live with this silence in our hearts. And every one of us is called to achieve it. Even as young, busy, and active university students, I encourage all of you, think differently about what it means to relax and to unwind and to rest. Rest is an awesome thing. God rested on the seventh day. God rests. To rest is to rest with God. Let this shape our use of technology. Let us not distract ourselves. Let us see silence, for in silence we come to know God and to know ourselves. Know thyself. This is said to have been written over the temple of Apollo at Delphi. It is one of the deepest and wisest imperatives in the heritage of the West. Receiving this imperative from Platonism, St. Augustine inscribed it when within the Christian tradition, when he wrote, "Return to yourself, from the things that are outside you. And then give yourself back to Him who made you, and enter to you into yourself, and leave behind all noise and confusion. God speaks to us in the great silence of the heart. As a young student and professor of rhetoric at Milan University, St. Augustine knew all too well the negative noises competing for his heart, describing them as producing twisted and tangled nonsense. Yet, through all these struggles, he would discover for us all, in a special psychological manner, that it is in the silence of the heart that we encounter the Lord. He too would go on to become a priest, bishop, doctor of the church, and a saint. St. Augustine also warns us that our self-understanding is shaped by those things to which we give our time and our attention. In other words, if we give to ephemeral and insignificant things, we will soon understand ourselves also as ephemeral and insignificant. If, however, we attend to beautiful and eternal things, we will also understand ourselves as beautiful and eternal. This truth offers us an important perspective on worldly affairs and on our connectedness to them. Through our use of technology, technology impacts the way we understand ourselves. When we do not use technology carefully, we risk losing sight of our very dignity. Many people today never separate themselves from constant exposure to ephemeral and insignificant words, stories, and gossip. Many of us here might do this too. Beware the effect of this constant exposure. We risk coming to an understanding of ourselves in the same way, ephemeral as insignificant. Here today, gone tomorrow, invented for pleasure or for profit, remembered by no one, loved by no one. Return to yourself, says Augustine. In contrast to noise of the world, every one of us has a capacity to cultivate silence within our hearts. There we find something enduring. There we find something beautiful. It is sometimes suggested that the movement of the heart is less real than the external things of the physical world. But this is not true. The noise of the heart passes like the noise of the world. But the silence within the heart is eternal. To attend to that silence is to recognize that it is eternal. To attend to that silence is to recognize that it is the holy place of God, His image and His presence within us. This ought to shape how we understand ourselves. We are children of God, in whose eternal souls He dwells. From the silence of our hearts, this is the identity we receive. Consider the word identity. It's come from Latin, idem, meaning the same. Our deepest identity is that which remains constant in us. It is what makes us the same person, day after day, place after place, job after job. Our identity is who we are. To have an identity is precisely not to be ephemeral, not to be noise. In time, when we hear much talk of gender and identity, when we witness great worldly struggles over gender identity, it is all the more important to cultivate silence, to step away from the noise of the world and its passing crisis, and to enter into silence in order to discover who we are, what remains the same within us. The silence in our hearts remains the same. The silent presence of God remains the same. In the silence of our hearts, we discover our own identities. We discover who we are and who God calls us to be. This is profound truth. We have an identity. Each of you has an identity. There is something constant in each of us. God dwells in each of us. Indeed, we are the stronghold, the dwelling place of God. He is here in the silence of our hearts. Why does our identity matter? It orients us in the world. It roots us in the passage of time. It provides each of us with the unique perspective from which we act in the world. To know ourselves, to receive our God-given identities in our hearts, is necessary to act well. When we retreat from the noise of the world and into silence, we gain a new perspective on the noise. When we retreat from the crisis of the world into silent praises of God, we gain a new perspective on those crises. When we retreat from the noise that shapes our thoughts and feelings, and instead rest in silence, we gain a new perspective on our own thoughts and feelings, as well as the thought and feeling of others. To retreat into silence is to come to know ourselves, to know our eternal dignity, to know the eternal presence of God. In silence, we learn who we are, who God calls us to be, and what God called us to do. Let these two shape our use of technology. We ought never to permit technology to obscure human dignity or to cheapen our understanding of ourselves and our lives and the lives of others. Technology exists so that by our connectedness we might better build up one another, not use them or tear them down. To do this, we must attend to the silence in our hearts. We must retreat at times from the noise of the world and encourage others to do so too, so that they too may never lose sight of the silent presence of God that remains ever the same within our hearts. All of these things are revealed to us in silence: our identities, our dignity, our vocations, and the Lord who creates us, loves us, and saves us. In silence, we discover the purpose of our lives. In other words, in silence, we discover our proper ends. From these ends, we develop goals fitting to the particular situations in which we find ourselves and determine the appropriate means for pursuing these goals. We must always keep this practical distinction clear in our minds: the distinction between ends and means. Technology is only ever a means. Technological development is never an end in itself. At times, technology and technological development are treated as an end in themselves. But this is a grave mistake, because technology is a means by its nature. Technology does not satisfy our deepest longings and ultimate ends. Technology does not provide us with true rest. Technology does not reveal to us our own dignity, our own identity, or the present, or the silent presence of God within us. Here, I would like to address a question that concerns you as college students. As a prefect of the Vatican Department that oversees the sacred liturgy, I was pleased to read the overall goal of the University of St. Michael's College to be a learning community animated by the Spirit of Christ, dedicated to the formation of the whole person and nurtured by liturgical celebrations and other common activities. By its very nature, a university is a collective, communitarian, and communicative body. How then we, linguistic human beings, can discover our ends in silence collectively? Silence seems to be isolating. How we can be silent together in the way that is fruitful for our common life? The Christian tradition has an answer to this question. It is liturgy. Liturgy in Greek, liturgia, means public work. For Christians, it entails our collective prayer to God, our collective act of worship. It is the primary work of the Church. The Divine Liturgy, the Holy Sacrifice of Mass, is our greatest treasure, our participation in the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, our participation in the single, perfect act of worship of our Heavenly Father. When we participate in the liturgy, our hearts are formed together in communion according to what our Lord has revealed. That is why we return to it again and again. At times, we might lose sight of this formative dimension of the liturgy. At times, it might appear that liturgy is empty, noisy, pedantic, or theatrical. There are grave distortions of the sacred rites handed down to us by the Church. Liturgy ought to be divine and beautiful because it is our most holy, most sacred and beautiful act. And through the sacred words, the hymns, the chants, we ought to discern, as Pope Francis describes it, a sonorous thread of silence through which God speaks to us, His Church. Here, the silence in our hearts is one with the silence in the heart of the Church. Here, Christians find our identity, our dignity, our vocation, and our Lord. We ought always to keep this in our minds and our hearts. Our ultimate and supernatural end is participation in the divine life of the Blessed Trinity, participation in the eternal song and the eternal silence of the heavenly liturgy. Our end animates us and nourishes us. What we do in the world, our businesses with technology and with every other things given to us, ought never to obscure or to encroach upon the place where we hold our ultimate end in our hearts. This is why I spoke first about how each of us individually must learn to separate himself from the sources of distractions in life and to rest in silence. Then I spoke on how constant exposure to the news of the world erodes our sense of human dignity, how it undermines a healthy anthropology. Now, the conclusion to which this reflection are leading becomes clear. It is through the serenest thread of silence in our hearts, in the heavenly liturgy, that we enjoy communion, friendship, now and in eternity. What are you doing here, Elijah? Asked the still small voice of God. Let us attend to that voice. Let us recognize that it is not in the winds and the earthquake and the fires and all the passing events of the world that we find the voice of God. It is in the stillness and the quiet of our hearts, in the silence of our prayer. There we discover both the questions and the answers that will beautifully shape our lives. An awesome task is given to us, a difficult task. Every one of us has a responsibility to live freely, to live with dignity, to live according to our dignity and our identity, to live in friendship with God. To do this, we must learn to separate ourselves from distraction, to cultivate silence and the love of silence in our hearts. We must develop virtue and bring order in our internal lives. We must come to know ourselves and the dignity and the vocation with which we have been blessed. Finally, we must learn to govern ourselves and our world together in friendship with one another, making proper use of the world which our Lord has entrusted to us. Dear friends, I pray for you all here present, and I ask you to pray for me, so that we may together fulfill this awesome task entrusted to us, and that we may rest together in awesome silence of God. Thank you.